I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my turn till I met you. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my turn, yeah, till I made you. You called my name and I
Good morning and welcome to St. John's. My name is Mark and I am the youth pastor here. It is brilliant to have you here with us this morning. Whether you are joining us for the very first time or if you've been a member of St. John's and around for your entire life or anywhere in between, it is great to have you with us. If you're new or you haven't been around for very long, we would love to hear from you. You can email us at hello@stjohnsharborne.org. And likewise, if you want to find out more about who we are as a church, what is happening, and what kind of things go on and how you can get more involved, then you can go and find out more at our website, which is stjohnsharborne.org. Today, we are carrying on our series looking at the Father's love, and our associate vicar, John, will be speaking on fatherly love from the book of 1 John. We'll also have some sung worship. Sarah is going to kick us off with a thought and an activity. We'll have some prayers, an update from Nick Holt, who's one of our global partner support people, and a special announcement from Leonard, our vicar, as well. But as we start this morning, I want to read to you a couple of verses from the book of Romans, chapter 8, verses 15 to 16. And it says this, Romans 8, 15 to 16. So you have not received a spirit that makes you fearful slaves. Instead, you received God's spirit when he adopted you as his children. Now we call him Abba Father. For his spirit joins with our spirit to affirm that we are God's children. As we start our service this morning, I'm going to encourage you to have a moment of stillness and of quiet. You might like to hold out your hands. There's nothing special or magical about that. It's merely a way of physically using our bodies to hold out our hands, to position ourselves as if we were receiving a gift. You might want to close your eyes to avoid the distractions around you. And as we wait in a moment of quiet and of stillness, I pray that God's Holy Spirit would meet with each and every one of us, would join with our spirits this morning to show us, to reveal to us, to affirm to us that we are God's dearly loved children. So Holy Spirit, come and reveal that to us now. Amen.
Praises rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you, hope is there. We love. see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away, Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, you're worthy of all our praises. Find strength to face the day, and in your presence all our fears are washed away. 'Cause when we see you, 'cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day, and in your presence all our fears. Strength within the sorrow. There is beauty in our tears. And you meet us in our mourning with a love that casts out fear. are working in our waiting. You are sanctifying us. When beyond our understanding, you're teaching us to trust. Your plans are still to prosper. You've not forgotten us. You're with us in the fire and the flood. You're faithful forever. You're perfect in love. You are sovereign over us.
You are wisdom.
Here is my starting question for you this morning. When you first meet someone, how do you want to come across? What do you want them to see as your identifying features? And how would you describe yourself? Are you someone that is a keen sports player, someone that is a musician, a doctor, a teacher? Are you in year nine? Are you a tea lover rather than a coffee lover? Do you avidly support a very specific football team? Have a think about that. Maybe try and whittle it down to like three words or phrases on how you would describe your person. A bit like what you would do in your like Instagram or WhatsApp bio, like a really short description, just so everyone who would initially meet you knows what and who you are. And when you first meet someone, one of the very, very, very first things that you know about them is their name. You introduce yourself and you go, "Hi, my name's Sarah." And instantly there is a bit more knowledge there. And normally you end up going, "What is your surname?" So, "I'm Sarah Holbrook, nice to meet you." And instantly that surname kind of makes you stand out. It makes you work out who's they're part of, what family they are part of, who they're attached to. And this surname is so much more than just a name. It is how you are ordered in your register. It's how what you put on your email. It's what you sew into your school clothes. And it's on your name tags everywhere you go. So this is my name tag. So initially when people see me, when I'm wearing my name tag, they know my name, they know what I look like on a good day, and they know my job and who I work for. So when I wear this badge, you already know a little bit about me, just from the initial, like, initial meeting. Now, I wonder, when you were trying to think of those three phrases for how you would describe yourself, did a child of God come into that? The passage that we are going to look at today starts, the very first bit that it says, "See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God." And it goes on and talks about how there are so many things we don't know and we don't know what we're going to do, but we do know as a grounding that we are children of God. Now, I don't know about you, but that being a child of God is something that we should shout from the rooftops, that we should be a part of our identity and really should go right under our surnames when we're having our badges, or like our metaphorical badges. It's something that defines us and it shows that we are part of God's family. And this isn't just by accident, that we can see the Father's love by being part of his family. But this was no easy thing. God paid the ultimate sacrifice and he showed us the Father's love. The Father showed us how much he loved us by making us part of his family. In John 3:16, the classic Bible verse, which I love, it says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, so that anyone who believes in him will not perish but have eternal life." Because the Father loves us so much, he sacrifices one and only Son so that we can be called children of God. And I don't know about you, but I want that to be on my name tag. So my challenge today for you is to make your own personalised name tag. It can have on it your name. It could even have all of those identifying factors that you've had around you, but write big and bold in the middle shows that you are a child of God. And I want to wear this on my name tag, and for it to be one of the first things that people will know about me, because I am a child of God. And that is such a wonderful thing, to see how much love God has poured on us that we can be children of God.
So here we are on the last Sunday in June, and it's time to say a big thank you to some of the members of our paid staff team who are going to stop being on our paid staff. So to Fiona Gregson, who has been our associate priest for the last couple of years, and to Nathan Burden, who has been our community pastor for that same time. And also to Anthony Spencer, who has remained on the staff team for these last couple of years since his official retirement as Associate Vicar. So we want to say a big thank you to all of them as they seek to move on. Now, you probably know that Nathan is going to move across to be us on the staff team in the voluntary capacity, continue to do a lot of the things that he's done already. So we look forward to that. Fiona's going to step back for the summer in the first instance and just be thinking and praying about some possibilities for her future. So she'll be leaving the paid staff team and won't be on the voluntary staff team, at least in the foreseeable future. And Anthony's going to move across and continue to do some things. And we are going to call Anthony our Associate Vicar Emeritus, as we thought that would best sum up his role as he goes on doing a lot of the things that he's already been doing. So again, I really want to say a huge thank you to them. And we had just seen the church family at St. John's and beyond being blessed by all that they have brought. There are some tokens of appreciation that are going to be going their way, well, to Fiona and to Nathan as we seek to thank them. So thank you so much to them. Do be praying for them as they move across or on at these days. And we just ask that God would continue to bless them and to bless many people through them. I'm just going to pray a general prayer now. Father God, thank you so much for Fiona and for Nathan and for Anthony, and we pray for each of them that you would continue to guide them, work in them and work through them for your glory and the extension of your kingdom in the days to come. In Jesus' name, amen.
Right, today's reading is from 1 John chapter 3, verses 1 to 3, God's children. See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known. But we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. All who have hope in him purify themselves, just as he is pure. This is the word of the Lord.
Well, good morning. It is great to be together here this morning online at St. John's. My name is Jon Tattersall and I'm the Associate Vicar here at St. John's Harbour. And a few weeks ago, you might remember, if you were with us, Anthony Spencer kicked us off on our series of The Father's Love and reminded us of that classic Beatles song, All You Need Is Love. And he reminded us that whilst that's somewhat true, of course, the deeper truth, one that we're exploring in this sermon series, is that actually all we need and what our hearts long for is the Father's love. It's what we were made for. It's what our hearts long for. And when we turn to God, the Father, and know his love, we find the completeness that our souls ultimately crave. But before we get into any of that, I've got a question for you this morning. I want to ask you this question. Have you ever heard of this phrase? The main thing is to keep the main thing the main thing. Now, before you wonder what on earth I'm going on about, that kind of a phrase is used in lots of different ways. Sometimes it's used in the advertising world where where it's used to keep focus on the brand or the product that a company is being hired to sell or to push. And that might be why they use it. Sometimes it's used, of course, in the world of essay writing, where students are encouraged, rather than just to keep writing and writing and writing, but also to answer the question. The main thing is to keep the main thing the main thing. It helped me as a teenager, that saying, as well, when I was struggling to master the art of batting whilst playing cricket as a teenager and overthinking everything. One day on the way to a cricket match, my dad, who often played in the same team as me, gave me the best coaching advice that I think I've ever been given. And he said this: "John, cricket is really simple. See ball, hit ball." And I thought that was the most revolutionary thing that I had ever heard. And I decided to put that into practice as soon as I went in to bat that day. And I did. And as the bowler was coming in, I just thought, see ball, hit ball. And I can remember clearly connecting with the ball, launching the ball back over the bowler's head for my first ever straight six. It was a glorious moment. And I was reborn in that moment. And that became my mantra, my motto, my philosophy when it came to cricket. See ball, hit ball. And that became one of my specialist shots as well. Not sure I could do it now. The main thing was to make the main thing in my case. And in a way, these wonderful verses from John chapter 3, verses 1 to 3, has something similar to say to us about the Father's love. In this letter, John is writing to Christians in the early church, so a couple of decades after the events of Christ, the events of the cross, the events of the resurrection and of Pentecost. And he's warning, as so many of these letters from the early church do, against false teaching, against unhelpful distractions in the life of the church. And above all, he wants to make sure that the main thing, the Father's love, is always the main thing in the life of every believer and everyone who puts their faith in Jesus. And there are four things about that that John wants to say about. Firstly, the Father's love should amaze us. See what great love the Father has lavished upon us. Our Bible reading starts with, and that word see is better translated as behold or even look. The Greek word John uses here literally means be perceiving. And it's the same word that pops up in Luke's Gospel, chapter 24, as the resurrected Jesus stands amongst his disciples and shows them the marks on his body. "Look at my hands and feet," he says. "It is I. Touch me and see." Be perceiving. Behold. Understand what this means, he's saying, and hold on to it. And I love the German translation of this word see, behalten, which means to hold on to it or to keep hold of it. Now, some things grow commonplace over time, don't they? Like a route or a journey we've done 1,000 times before, or a thing or an experience or an idea that's so familiar it hardly even registers anymore. But the Father's great love for us should be like a much loved walk or a journey that we know so well, with familiar moments, but every so often we find a new turnoff or a view that we've never noticed before. It's an experience that should grow stronger and stronger over the years until it totally dominates every aspect of our lives. It should consume our thoughts. It should control our behaviour. It should motivate us to serve God and live holy lives. It should give us comfort in all of our trials. It should fill us with the eager hope of being with Him in heaven. It should fill us with awe and wonder and worship that He, the sovereign creator of the universe, would set His love on people like you and me. Amazing love, as the old hymn goes. How can it be that thou, my God, should die for me? Let's not allow ourselves to ever hear of the Father's great love and think, okay. It ought always to amaze us. And to do that, we've got to develop disciplines and behaviours that allows us to focus on making the main thing the main thing. It's such a battle, isn't it, in our culture of distraction, isn't it? I read an article recently talking about the effect of technology on our ability to focus. And in the article, it said this: we've become addicted to our devices, and crucially, this is not an accident. So, for example, there's the infinite scroll feature on social media, a design feature, deliberate design feature, that means we can keep scrolling, we can keep browsing social media, and we never reach an end point. If we receive a message from someone, the person who sent it is immediately informed that you've read it, increasing that pressure to respond straight away. And there's, of course, the pull of the like button. And the creator of the like button has started to campaign against some of its worst effects, particularly on teenagers, which turns every photo or every Winnie the Pooh quote that we could ever put up on social media into an opportunity to seek the jackpot of 50, 100 or even 1,000 likes. One tech commentator in the article says this: there's a war going on, and it's a war for your attention. This word from John then speaks as powerfully today as it did back then for the followers of Jesus. What is it that we behold? Do we need to recalibrate? One of my favourite quotes, I've used it before at St John's and I'll probably use it again, is from a guy called Greg Beale, a biblical scholar, and he says this: what we revere, we resemble for ruin or for restoration. What we revere, we resemble for ruin or for restoration. We think about some of the cultural icons and statues that we've been re-examining in the life of the nation and other nations too over the last few weeks. What is it we revere? What is it that we resemble? Are we willing to behold afresh the Father's love for us and remove all other distractions that would seek to make us look elsewhere? What if during this season that we find ourselves in now, as we get hold of the Father's love, what if we discover that God, the Father's plan, has been to get hold of us? The second thing John wants to say is the Father's love should instruct us. Have you ever spotted someone else's trainers or their clothes or an item that they own, maybe a gadget or something like that, which we like and we think is awesome and we think would suit us? And it's just the thing we've been looking for. And so we ask, where did you get that? See what great love the Father has for us. That word translated "how great" is literally "of what kind." It originally was linked to the statement of what country did this personal thing come from. It's as if John is thinking about the Father's great love and says, where does this come from? It must be from heaven, because there's nothing like it in this world. And we really know this, don't we, if we're being honest. Sometimes one of the biggest challenges that people face, even people who've been followers of Jesus for years and years, is the absence of good examples of fatherly love in our lives. In our world today, we know the experience of absent fathers, incompetent fathers, hurtful fathers, emotionally detached fathers, perfectionist fathers, and so on and so on. And so many of us carry the scars and the wounds inflicted on us by our experience of imperfect earthly fathers. However, I'm struck by the fact that one of the reasons that Jesus comes to earth, one of the reasons he says that he's here, is to reveal to the human race the perfect love of the Father. 175 times in the Gospel, Jesus uses that word, Father to connect us to God. And it's almost completely unique in any faith. It's unique to the Christian faith to some extent to address God in that intimate, relational way. Through faith in Jesus, who points us to the Father, we find a love that can heal all wounds and reach even the most shut off and shut down parts of our hearts, and corrects that view of God the Father that's either shaped by our earthly fathers or is shaped by some of the misteaching of the church over the last few hundred years. When we explore the Gospels and we see how Jesus encourages us to see God the Father, we see the softest, the kindest Father that could be possibly imagined. And we need to stop and meditate on the Father's love, to allow it to instruct us and to challenge us, to transform us. Now, it might be hard, it might be impossible even, to fully comprehend the enormity of God's love because of our earthly experiences. But stopping regularly to behold it, to think about it, to revel in it, is to allow it to instruct us about what he is actually like and to start the process of allowing it to change us. Have we, in the words of a worship song, allowed our hearts to grow cold? Do we need to light the fire again in our hearts? It starts with beholding his love and allowing that love then to instruct us, to thaw us and reach the deepest hurts and pains that are within us. In the classic book, The Lion, the Witch and the Wardrobe, C.S. Lewis tells of how once he's restored to life, Aslan heads towards the witch's castle and breathes life on those whom the witch has made into statues. I cannot think of a better way of framing what God the Father's perfect heavenly love does for us. It can melt the hardest heart of stone and instructs us in what true love really looks like. True love, the Father's love, breathes life. Isn't this so needed in our world today? And in the light of the conversations recently about the evils and the blight of racism and discrimination in our world, what's the answer to that evil? Well, ultimately, it's what transforms a heart of stone to a heart of flesh. The Father's love available to us through faith in Jesus. Do we know it? Does it characterize us? Do we need to behold it again today and ask for the Father to send his Holy Spirit to breathe life into us? Thirdly, the Father's love tells us who we are, that we might be called the children of God, for that is what we are. Say that with me right now at home. That we might be called the children of God, for that is who we are. That is what we are. That is who we are. That title reveals our true condition, our true image if we're in Christ. John leaves us in no doubt that the divine call is an effectual call. We are what God calls us, and what God calls us, we are. The idea is that we not only have a name change or a title change, children of God, but that that title reflects our true condition. Through his power, God causes us to be born again through his Son, through faith in Christ and through the Holy Spirit. He imparts new life to us so that we're raised from spiritual death to spiritual life. We actually get to share his very life if we want it. That's what it means to be his children, being given a new image, but also being made over gradually, day by day, into that new image. It's not an external image makeover. It's an internal change of identity in our deepest place that sets us free to be who he always made us to be. And get this, this is the best bit. It nullifies any word that's previously been spoken over us. I wonder if we need that today. I wonder if our hearts are crying out for that today. How important might that be for us right now? Are we willing to walk in that identity afresh today? And also to speak it over our brothers and sisters in Christ in the world who've been maligned and denigrated. But there's a consequence to all of this, John wants to say. Lastly, that God the Father's love should distinguish us from the world. John says, the reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Because of this divide, if we know love in Jesus Christ, then there's a sense that we're aliens in the world. The Bible actually speaks in that way. There might be times when we should feel like an alien in certain company, or when we encounter a world that's rejected God's authority, love, and sovereignty. We might not even expect to be popular in the world's eyes, as many of our brothers and sisters in Christ around the world experience today. And that's because there's a greater call upon our lives, one that we cannot deny, we cannot turn aside or detach ourselves from. When we behold the Father's love, the awesome love of God the Father, lavished upon us, knowing that we are God's children, not through any merit of our own, but because the light of the world stepped down into the darkness, opened our eyes and let us see who we really are and who he really is. When we know that, nothing else is good enough. Nothing else comes close. And as we look to him on the cross, the resurrected Saviour too, the things of this world will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. But does this mean that we separate ourselves from this world? No, we're no better than anybody else, of course. We're no more loved than anybody else. But God the Father's love compelled him to send his son Jesus into the world. And so all of us, as we were all once outsiders and alienated from God's love, we are called to go into this world so that we might share that love with others. The Father's love distinguishes us because we're willing to do the same, to go into this world and show that same sacrificial love. Sometimes we have to be honest and say we've got this wrong as God's people, and as the church, we've not reflected in any way that Father's love. It hasn't distinguished us in the way it should. Or maybe it hasn't distinguished us at all. And so this morning, we need to be amazed all over again by God the Father's love for us. As we behold it, as we hold on to it, may we be changed as his love instructs us. May we know we are his children. And may we take that message out into a world so desperately in need of hearing it. Friends, this is the God that we pray to when we get on our knees. He is the Father who, when we were still far off, runs to embrace us in his Son, Jesus Christ. He's not like our earthly fathers. His love is perfect. His love is passionate and fiercely for you. Let's make sure that the main thing in our lives, our main endeavour, our main and our entire life's purpose is to make the main thing, God the Father's love for us, the main thing. Amen.
I have heard so many songs. Listen to you. Perfect. sing over me the Father's song, heaven's perfect mystery. The King of love has sent for me, and now you're singing over me the Father's song. Heaven's perfect melody, the Creator's symphony. You are singing over me the Father's song. Heaven's perfect mystery, the King of love has sent for me. The song, the Father's love, you sung it over me, and for eternity it's written on my heart. Hi,
St. John's. This is Nick Holt and Christina Holt, and we're the pastors of Southgate Family Church. And we planted this church in Kings Norton on the Three Estates, deprived part of Birmingham, about 10 years ago from St. John's. And we've just been making disciples and doing our bit to build God's kingdom. It's been an amazing time. We've grown from around about, just the handful that we were, to over 150 people in our core, with a huge fringe above and around that. And there's enormous need. During this pandemic, obviously, there's extra challenges. We normally run a food bank, and largely how we're spending our time at the moment is just feeding people. So we've linked up with the supermarkets and food share, and we're currently supporting around about 760 people a week. And the church have been amazing. Our church are mainly new believers, so many of them are very new in their faith, and it's just wonderful. And seeing how they support their own community, there's just so much goodwill. And everyone who comes to the food bank receives prayer, or is certainly offered prayer. And most, and amazingly, most people are coming back and saying, "Oh, would you pray for this? Would you pray for that?" They're now asking us for prayer. It's just part of what they receive when they come, which is just lovely. Creates a fantastic foundation to talk about Jesus, to talk about the gospel, and there's just been loads of wonderful moments. People have received Jesus. On top of that, or next to that, should I say, we run a daily Bible study on Facebook Live. We've just been going through the New Testament. That's been such a joy. Just have that time actually to spend in the Word. It's one of God's words to us this year, is to be dedicated to the Word. So that's just happened naturally. But so many people who are coming are now tuning into the Bible studies and listening and just beginning to get into the Word of God, which is fantastic. But we need prayer. We've got this huge need. There's a huge opportunity, and it's so exciting. So I've just recorded a bit of footage to show you how it works, and I will see you in a second. So just out standing outside the house, and there's a bunch of people waiting in queue. This is actually just the end of the session, and but people will queue all the way down to the road, and twice a week for 2 hours. And it's just an amazing opportunity to feed people, build relationships, build the kingdom, and have those conversations. Everyone who comes receives prayer. We offer to pray for people, and just gives way to some amazing conversations. Let me just pop back inside, and then we'll finish up.
Oh, okay.
I'm just coming downstairs just to show you the food bank. This is some of our volunteers.
Hi.
Hi, some other volunteers over here. And as you can see, we've got just absolutely just stacks of food. Our house has turned into like a mini shop, and it's been just such a joy. You know, some of the comments and the feedback people have explained, they just haven't had enough food. So it's such an amazing way to just a practical way to show some love. And to build some good community. Loads of opportunities to pray for people and talk about Jesus. So we need prayer. Yes, we need prayer. So thank you, St. John's, for praying for us and getting behind what God is doing here. We really value it. And be blessed. We pray that God blesses you during this time and you also find yourself opportunities to pray for people and to sow seeds and build God's kingdom. All right, bye from us.
As we continue to reflect on what John has shared with us, we're going to pray together. And our prayers today are going to be led by the home group that Malobi, Stella, Matthew and myself lead. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your amazing and life-giving love. May we know your love for us today. And may we know our identity as your beloved children. May we be formed by your love and grow in sharing that love with one another and with those around us. God of love, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those in particular need today, for those who are unwell, for those who are grieving, for those who are lonely, for those who are facing challenges at this time. And Lord, we ask that you will meet with each one of them, with your care, with your love, with your comfort, with your healing, with your peace. God of love, in your mercy, hear our prayer. As Anthony and Nathan transition into their roles on the volunteer staff team, we thank you for their ministry amongst us and their ministry in the community around us. We ask that you will continue to sustain, lead and equip them. God of love, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Father God, we pray for the frontline workers who continuously do their job in the NHS. May you give them strength, guidance, and protection, and pray that they would come to know and trust in you. Let the Holy Spirit fill and be with each and every one. God of love, in your mercy, hear our prayers.
Lord, we pray for your guidance to all students and universities. We pray for a rigid and strong support provided by universities to students who go back to campus to learn. Lord, we pray for students who graduate this year. It is going to be a difficult year for them to find employment. So Lord, we pray for your wisdom, guidance, support, and provision. God of love, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Lord God, we pray for those who are homeless, that you would provide them with food and places to live. God of love, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
We are going to pray for two parts of the world, which have St. John's connections, which are having problems at the moment from the coronavirus. The first place we want to think about, to pray about, is Peru, where Penny and Carlos are working. Lord, we pray for their work with the soup kitchens, where they are supporting poor people who have little or no food to eat, little or no income. I just pray for their ministry and support, and their love and their kindness, and your love and kindness into this difficult situation. Thank you. And then we also think of Lebanon, where Hikret and Krista are working with the Resurrection Church, where they're having both economic problems as well as the coronavirus problems. And again, they're ministering to the poor people there, giving them help and support and your love and support. And just pray for their ministry there and the love they're giving to the poor people and the people who've got very much, haven't got very much. And then finally, just remember other places where the coronavirus is bad, thinking of Brazil, Pakistan and India. God of love, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
This morning we pray for Fiona on her last Sunday in her current role at St John's. We thank you, God, for her ministry amongst us during the past year and in previous years. We thank you, Holy Spirit, for her encouraging preaching, leading, and times of prayer in Sunday services and on other occasions. We thank you, Lord, for her personal help, her open listening, and her ability to get alongside, for her advice and guidance, and her pastoral heart on the many hidden times when we needed it. As a church, we thank God for her ministry of caring for all the small groups, for encouraging each one of us to be in a group, and for our groups to be church for each other, and welcoming to newcomers. On behalf of our home group, we especially want to thank God for Fiona, Matthew and Hannah, for their partnership in leading us. We thank you for the opportunity to share with one another from around the world the riches of fellowship in Christ. We pray, O God, that you will guide Fiona into just the right new areas of ministry for her as she leaves the staff team. Help her to be sensitive to your voice, to hear you when you call, and to know the security of being led by you into her next role. God of love, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Father, we want to thank you for St. John's. Thank you for all the people who worship here and have worshiped here, and all the lives that are touched. And we bring ourselves before you as individuals and pray that you will help us to show your love. Help us to reach out to the Jerusalems where you've planted us and to the people we see each day. Thank you, Lord, for each home group. And we ask that you will help us in home groups to be thinking about how we can further your kingdom, how we can show your love. We remember our building, not just for the sake of a building, but because we want to extend your kingdom, because we want it to be a place where we can do mission. And we ask, Lord, that as the building continues, you keep the people safe, but that you continue to give each of us and the heads of sections your plans, your purposes for how we use this building. We've decided to go back into it first before we really put those things into practice. And we just ask for your continued direction and for your grace as we do all these things. We remember the leadership you've given us at St. John's, and we pray using our vicar as a point of contact that you will continue to give them your love in their hearts for one another and for the work that they oversee, and help them to make the right decisions from day to day. We know, Lord, that you are the one who builds your kingdom, and we thank you that day by day you will continue to do that at St. John's. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's bring our prayers to a close in the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
That the highest King would welcome me. I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. To the sun.
That is all for today. Thank you for joining us. We hope you've had a brilliant morning and met with God in a particular and special way. There is no midweek encouragement coming up on Wednesday, the 1st of July, but instead of that, we have our monthly prayer gathering called Powerhouse. So please do join in with that with us at 8 p.m. this Wednesday, the 1st of July. Next Sunday, during our online service, we're going to be sharing an agape meal together as a church. So there'll be more information about that coming out and on Sunday morning itself. But do come ready with some bread and wine or grape juice of your choice. It's been brilliant to worship together as church this morning. So go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. When I met you, oh, when it said, when you called my name, come on, and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into your glorious day, you called my name.
This is my story. This is your story. Come on, listen.
I needed rescue. My sin was heavy. But chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter. I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven. Where I was.